Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. And I wanted to talk to you guys about the Antichrist. I know I keep promising people I'm going to teach about faith. And if you watch my videos, I always throw in a little nugget about faith in my videos. So let me give you one now. There are several of them that just come to my mind as I said that, where the Bible says that, you know, the Word of God is, you know, life and health to our bones. From the Proverbs, I believe, chapter 5. But right now, I want to look at Isaiah 43, 26. And God is talking about, he says, put me in remembrance, let us plead together. Declare thou that thou mayest be justified. So this is one of the verses that I use. It reminds me, you know, to put God in remembrance of his word. Of course, he knows his word. But brothers and sisters, our faith, you know, we can generally say, which is true, ultimately, my faith, and I'm resting in the goodness of God and the love of the Lord, that I'm saved through Jesus Christ and all that stuff. But when you begin to try to get serious about faith and pray for specific things, brothers and sisters, there's an old hymnal song that says, standing on the promises of God. You know, and you have to stand on the promises of God. So the Bible says his answers are yes and amen. So he says here, this is what I do when I pray by faith. And, you know, I've had many breakthroughs with the Lord, brothers and sisters. You know, and I've been, as a matter of fact, Brother Egroff had asked me many times to do a video on my testimony. I've done a little bit. Jason Egroff of the Revelation News, and I think it's Sabbath Night Live or whatever. He was doing his different radio shows. Anyway, he's asked me several times in the past to do a testimonial video. And you know, I just put a little here and there, brothers and sisters, a little bit here and there about faith. And I need to do lots of teaching on faith. But faith is the key, brothers and sisters. You know, very few people make it to go be missionary places in the amount of people in the body of Christ who are really called to do it. It takes a lot of faith, a lot of perseverance and prayer and dedication to go do things for God. You know, there's lots of people who talk a good game, who talk a good game about praying and faith and all that. And I'm not talking about salvation. I'm talking about doing the will of God. Seeing the will of God done in your life as it is in heaven. Seeing the will of God done in your family as it is in heaven. In your neighborhood and in your church. And in your Christian community that you deal with. You know, known as the church. You have a group of people. You have a Bible study. It's also the church, a gathering, ecclesia. I call that group of believers. The will of God is done by faith. We acquire the things of God. Without faith, it's impossible to please him, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So it's faith. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. I've heard lots of Baptist preachers, I know, because they're against, you know, the faith movement. They'll say that the faith is, they'll put the accent and say that it's the faith. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, that the faith is not your own, but a gift of God. No, the grace from God is not your own. The opportunity to repent and get saved is from God, but the faith is yours. My Bible says God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. So we all have a measure of faith. And then there is the gift of faith for supernatural things. I was just talking about the other day, the gift of faith. A great example is the Lord saying to people, hey, go lay hands on that person. I'm going to raise him from the dead. Now, besides healing and all those other things that would happen in the process of laying hands on someone to be raised from the dead, the act of having supernatural extra faith to go lay hands on people to be healed, raised from the dead, is above and beyond the ordinary faith that we have as Christians. Now, the faith we have as Christians, the measure of faith we have, is for salvation. And then it's for believing the Word of God. So the Lord says in Isaiah 43, 26, put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. You know, back in Isaiah chapter 1, there are similar words that the Lord is using through the prophet Isaiah. He says, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall become white as snow. Even though they're like hyssop, they'll become white like wool. So God is saying, let us reason together. You know, you've got sins, they can be forgiven. Even in this one, in 43:25, he says, I am he that blotteth out thy transgression for my own sake and will not remember thy sins. See, he's referring back to the same thing as he did back there in the beginning of Isaiah. And then he says here, Isaiah 43:26. But put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. Declare thou that thou mayest be justified. So remind the Lord of his word. Remind him that he said that I will blot out your transgressions for my own sake. For mine own sake. And will not remember them anymore. Call the Lord to remembrance of his word. Put him in remembrance of his word. Just like the enemy is attacking you in all different ways. You know, like if you've been watching my videos, remember at the time that Joshua died, my stepson, which the outcome of that was Joshua's ministry. That's the standard that the Lord raised up. The flood of the enemy came in my house, literally flooded. The pipe, the water pipe from the septic tank is somehow joined together with a sink pipe because it's cheap and substandard plumbing there in this subdivision I was living in the Philippines. And somehow it got clogged up, and when it rained, the actual septic tank backed up into the house and flooded the house from the septic tank, brothers and sisters. If you watch my videos, you'll remember that happened. So it was literally a flood. Joshua got dengue fever and died. We went to the funeral at my wife's family's ancestral homeland area, their land. On the way back, it was a flash flood, and we nearly drowned. The water was above the top of the tires, brothers and sisters, and it was like a raging river, full of coconuts and palm branches and all this stuff. And I mean, and there were cars that were swept off out into the ocean, because this was an area, you know, the highway is just right by the ocean. The road, it's not, they call it a highway, but it's a two-lane road. And it was a raging flood, and it was just a sudden flash flood. And, you know, by grace of God, I was right behind a big 18-wheeler truck. And I just followed him through and tried to stay in his tracks. But the water, the oil in my rear end was contaminated of my car. And the water was above the tires. There was no way I would have thought we would have not got swept away when I saw the watermark and leaves stuck in my car over halfway up the car doors. We began to pray. As a matter of fact, there are a few times when my wife has really, you know, surprised me. Because, you know, I always think, you know, like most of, you know, I'm a preacher, so my wife's usually not, you know, at the level I am with the Lord, right? But at that moment, you know, I was like, what in the world is going on? And I was just I was freaking out. And my wife said, let's pray. And, of course I knew that, but I was just like, this is unbelievable. I was so mad that God allowed that to happen to us after we just came from Joshua's funeral. That I was just dumbfounded to pray. And my wife said, let's pray. So we started praying. And one of my sister-in-laws was with us. And then by a miracle of God, we made it through that flash flood. It was very scary. I'm laughing because my sister-in-law, she had to go to the bathroom immediately as soon as we got through the flash flood. It scared her to death. And of course it was, but I mean at the moment for me, I wasn't afraid. I was just shocked of what was happening to us, that flood. And then when we got home, the septic tank was backing up and filling the whole house, brothers and sisters. And just as we had applied for my wife's visa, for her green card, and we couldn't move to a new address. If we'd have moved to a new address, because we were renting, if I'd moved to a new address, I'd have to go back to Manila and try to file a paperwork with the embassy. And it would have delayed her packet. And so I was like, hey, you know, we can't move. We got to try to get this fixed. Anyway, brothers and sisters, there's a lot of other things going on. Yeah, I had a tooth that broke too. Those who were watching. Several other things, brothers and sisters. I can't remember what all it was now. But anyway, I began to plead the word of God, where God said, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. And then Isaiah 54:17 says, why am I having trouble remembering that verse the last 2 days? See, I better look it up. 55 or 54:17, it says that, let me look it up, I got it right here in front of me. It says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every tongue that rises up against thee, thou shalt condemn. This is the inheritance of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, says the Lord. It's 54. Let's look. I got it right here. I got my e-sword. The great free Bible. You can word search words, esword.com. I can't recommend it enough. You got the King James. I got the King James Plus. And the King James Plus, brothers and sisters, it's got like the Greek or the Hebrew for the Old Testament, Greek for the New Testament. Right beside it in green, you just hold your little cursor over there, and it'll give you the original word from the original text. Okay. Isaiah 54:17. No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that rises up against thee that in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the saints of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. I started quoting that one. That no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. I started quoting them when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. I began to quote these verses. And the Lord says he gives us all power over the enemy. So in that situation. And then I had another cycle that wasn't as bad, where I had all these other stuff going on at the same time. After that, I can't remember what it was, but it was a lot less stuff than people dying and almost being killed in the flood and all that. But it was still a bad cycle, but not like that one. And still, I did the same thing again, brothers and sisters. This is an example where we have to fight the good fight of faith, the Bible says. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold of eternal life. And brothers and sisters, that is our fight. As it says, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and forces of darkness in high places. What does Paul tell us to do in Ephesians chapter 6 when he talks about the armor of God? It says, put on the helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation. You know you're saved. You put on the breastplate of righteousness. In other words, are we going to be perfect? No, but you walk in righteousness. You walk in righteousness. Give no place to the enemy, the Bible says. You don't give the enemy an opening. Brothers and sisters, let me give you an example of that, of my own life. And it seems that's what the Lord has had me do in his video. I've got a brother who's he's still on drugs. He's a druggie, on and off drugs, on and off. But he's never, you know, got saved. He won't get saved. He's like an atheist or agnostic. And you know, he won't even go to AA or none of that. So he's get himself off, allegedly, for a season and go back to alcohol and drugs and all that. So anyway, my other brother's daughter, who's an adult, she was like 17 or 16 at the time, she had been dabbling a little bit with some stuff with my other brother. And she was at my parents' house, and my mom says, hey, can you come over and pray for your niece? So I was like, all right. Now, like you guys who watch my videos, you know my mom is, you know, not a super Christian, but she's born again. And anyway, so, you know, she called me and wanted me to pray with her. So I was like, well, that's great. You know, it must be bad, which I already knew it was. So anyway, I go over there, brothers and sisters, on the way over there, on the way to my parents' house. The Lord spoke to me out of the blue and said, sanctify thyself, sanctify thyself. See, for all you guys who love to quote Bible verses that God's no respecter of persons, that means anybody can get saved. God has given some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, teachers, and evangelists for the perfecting of the saints, Ephesians 4:11. God gives us different callings, different offices, let me just be blunt. There are your denominational people, specifically those who believe the word and interpret it their own way. This is the largest group in the United States. The largest denomination is Southern Baptists and all the other Baptists, Bible Baptists, etc. They're the ones who are primarily the largest group of Christians in the United States and probably the largest group of my video watchers. And that's why, you know, the Lord, I came from a Baptist background. That's why the Lord is using me to bring out these fallacies and false teachings, that it would be exposed and be brought into the light. Okay, now being saved and being a born again, brand new baby Christian doesn't give you the right, even though we have authority in Christ, okay, we have authority in Christ, to cast out demons and all that stuff. All Christians do, brothers and sisters. But there are people who are called to do that. God equips us and anoints us. That's why Paul talks, and that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the armor of God. You know, we have to put on the armor of God. And what does Paul say? You know, after you've been attacked and beat down and all that, Paul says, when you have nothing else left to do, stand. And having done all, stand. You know, stand by faith with your armor of God on. So if you are not wearing a breastplate of righteousness, the enemy can stab you. And then the main topic I'm talking about in this preaching, I guess, sermon, if whatever you want to call it, is that shield of faith. It says it will stop the fiery darts of the enemy. I'm talking out of Ephesians chapter 6 for all of this, for the armor of God. So the enemy is shooting fiery darts. If you don't have your shield of faith, you know, and that's what happens to me, you know, anybody but me, even me sometimes. You know, even though I've been through lots of things with the Philippines and being a pastor and for 14 years and going to Philippines and doing mission work and planting churches here in the States, planting churches in the Philippines, all those things, orphanages and all that, the enemy can still come at you. He always does that. He knows what your weakness is. And so that's why when these old denominational people think because they got saved that they're some general for God and God's no respecter of persons, you know, and that's particularly true on you two because you're dealing with outlaw Christians. Now, brothers and sisters, you know, when I say that, I always have to qualify that, you know, by the two extremes. You've got people who worship the church, that the church is the way, the truth, and the life. As an example, as I mention regularly, and it's true, Roman Catholicism teaches that grace comes to you by partaking of the sacraments, like the communion. Only an ordained Catholic priest can give you the sacraments. The bishop over your area, your archdiocese and all that, you know, the archbishop and the bishop and all that, they can remove your right to take communion. They can refuse to give you the last rites or extreme unction, they call it. They can refuse to give you the sacraments. They can excommunicate you. So in other words, they have the authority to withhold God's grace from you, and therefore they become the way, the truth, and the life. And no person can come to Jesus except through the church, in this case, the Catholic Church. Okay, now, lots of these, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and all them, they all kind of have similar stuff where, you know, you got to come through them. Okay, but particularly, we're talking about the biggest group, of course, is Roman Catholicism. Okay, that being said, I always had to put that out there. But on the other extreme, on YouTube, lots of people are outlaws. They're lawless people. You know, not everybody's John the Baptist. You know, not everybody's called to live in the wilderness and eat wild locusts and honey and wear, you know, camel skin, goat hair. But, you know, there's an in-between, and that's just the same thing that I teach about all the time about grace versus works. You know, there's the greasy gracers. This same group, primarily the biggest group in the United States, the Baptist people, believe that you can say a prayer, their basic teaching. Not all of them believe that. Not all Baptists believe this. Generally speaking, that you can go to the altar as an 8-year-old kid at Vacation Bible School and say the sinner's prayer, and whether you meant it or not or understood it or not, you can go live like the devil the rest of your life, even proclaiming that you don't believe in God anymore and all this, that, and the other, but you're sealed to the day of redemption. When you die, you're going to heaven no matter what you say, what you do. Okay, that's one extreme. And then the other extreme is you have to be perfect to enter heaven. That is also not true. You can never be perfect. That's why the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not a one. And that's true. Our righteousness comes by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. God gives us his righteousness. But, brothers and sisters, we are called, as Peter said, be ye holy, for I am holy. Jesus said, be ye perfect, even as your heavenly Father who is perfect, in the Sermon on the Mount. So we are called to walk in righteousness and holiness, and that is the breastplate that protects us. I need to do a video on each one of these, brothers and sisters. I'm just doing a general overview right now. That breastplate of righteousness protects us, protects our heart, and the shield of faith. You know, I know who I am in Christ. I know who I am in Christ. As I mentioned, even myself, those little things are the things that annoy me. You know, in the Philippines, I've got neighbors who are loud. They're partying all night, banging around, making all this noise. Those are the things that bother me. Some people, that doesn't bother them. But if the least little thing goes wrong, they go off the deep end as far as, you know, the Lord led them to build an orphanage, as an example. And then, you know, the construction is a day late, and then they go off the deep end, and where's the Lord? The Lord's forsaken us. But for me, those big projects, that doesn't move me. I am totally, by the grace of God, by God's Spirit working in me, you know, I can do all things, all those things through Christ that strengthens me. It's the little things in the flesh that always bother me. But everybody's got their own weaknesses. The enemy knows that, brothers and sisters. He has been studying mankind for 6,000 plus years. He knows our weaknesses, whether it be adultery, pornography, you know, and all of those things. You know, I don't want to use the word, but well, I guess I should. You know, self. Sex selfie. How about that? That's a new term. Sex selfie. But not a picture. You know what I'm saying? People get, you know, they have their, everybody has their weaknesses, whether it be alcohol, you know, whatever we have in our lives. The enemy knows that, brothers and sisters. Don't you know that he wants to try to form that weapon against you, brothers and sisters? He likes to copy God. You know, God moves in patterns. The enemy moves in patterns. You know, and he knows that, you know, all of you guys who are watching this, Probably most of you have been a Christian for a while. You know those things that trip your trigger. You know those things that make you mad. You know, whether it be the traffic jam, things like that, like myself. I hate being late. Filipinos are always way late. You know, I have a Filipino wife. You know, so like myself, when I go preach somewhere, and even in the Philippines, and then it's always when you're in a hurry that the traffic has stopped, right? I mean, when you're not in a hurry, there's, you know, you're just cruising and everything's cool. But when you're in a hurry, especially like me, I'm dressed, ready to go preach, and then boom, you're stuck in traffic. You know, my wife's not ready to go on time. All these things, it just gets under your skin. And that's how I am. Those are the things that get me all fired up. And then I'm saying, hey, I'm getting ready to go preach. You know, I don't want to get in the flesh. So that's an example of what you got to do. And this is a simple example. Start playing Christian music in your car. In the Philippines, I didn't have a radio in my car. But when I was getting ready to leave, when I came to the States last time, one of my wife's uncles who does the coconut farms for us, he has a bunch of coconut farms. He's buying the car. He bought the car, my car, from me. So he used it while I was in the States last time. He put a radio in there. And I'd been thinking about it for years. He put a radio in there, and then I was able to hook up my MP3 player. When I was back in the Philippines this last time, I planned for years that I didn't spend the money to do it, didn't want to spend the money on a radio. Plug in that MP3 player, I can listen to the Bible, and that's what I'm doing here in the States. I can listen to the Bible, I can listen to Christian music, and then worship the Lord, praise the Lord, concentrate on listening to the Bible, and not be moved by a traffic jam. This is a simple example, brothers and sisters, of how we can thwart the enemy's plan by using the Word of God, praise and worship, and getting in the Spirit and staying out of the flesh. Anyway, so I'm talking about the armor of God. Now, the big picture of what I'm talking about is faith. Okay, so let's see. our battle, brothers and sisters, as Paul says in there, is not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and forces of darkness in high places. But how do we beat them? Paul says to stand. So what do? We put on the armor, and then we have faith. So I need to do a video on each one of these things of the armor. There's only one offensive armor weapon. That's the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And let me just touch on that while I'm still going on this. Jesus gave us a perfect example of defeating the enemy as an anointed, Spirit-filled human. Jesus laid aside his Godhood and walked as a man. As I mentioned in videos before, the Holy Spirit came upon him and led him into the wilderness. He was led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. He operated as a Spirit-filled, as a Pentecostal man. And Jesus walked as a Spirit-filled man. And when he was confronted by the enemy, what did Jesus do? The enemy said to him, oh, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Jesus used the word. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Okay, you know, it's in my mind to say this because there are always those people. Jesus was a Spirit-filled man, but Pentecost had not happened. New Testament Pentecostal speaking in tongues had not happened yet. That was a gift given to the church. There was no church until after the resurrection of Christ, brothers and sisters, just to put that out there. When I say Jesus was a Pentecostal man, I mean he was filled with the Holy Spirit, and there was no speaking in tongues until the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Just to put that on there for all those certain people, brothers and sisters. You know, lots of times people who make videos, they just go ahead and say whatever they want to say, and then they don't follow up on these things. But me, I like to avoid controversy and misunderstandings about doctrine. So that's why I'm a stickler to go back and make sure that I laid that word out there right so people can have a complete understanding to avoid mass confusion. You know, and maybe my method does not work as good as like Paul Begley. He just drives forward, you know, and says what is in his mind and doesn't think along theological lines, and it's, you know, he has lots of viewers, so it must be a good technique to do that, just to plow through and ignore the comments and just let it flow, let the comments flow, and just because there's no way as many comments as he has, he would even have the time to go back and look at the comments either. But me, I like to keep a tight ship. I like to make sure that I'm theologically grounded, and I believe that's what God put me on YouTube for, so I always try to circle back around, make sure I didn't leave anybody behind. And, you know, and I am open to, you know, that if I make a mistake, to get it right. You know, that's why I like to think about it, go back, circle back around, and bring it back in again, brothers and sisters. Because, you know, we have different callings. And my calling is, you know, you don't know how many people, brothers and sisters, who've watched my videos, who've messaged me and said, hey, Brother Patrick, you know, I thought speaking in tongues was from the devil, and after listening to your videos, I know it's not. I know you're a spirit-filled man of God. I know you're rooted and grounded in the Word, and thank you. And now I'm seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Tons of people have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you know, from hearing the proper theological teaching from my channel. Dozens and dozens of people, you know, have said, you know, rededicated their life. They came back because of sound theological teaching. You know, they were out of walking with the Lord because of some wacky doctrines. You know, so there's different reasons why people come back to the Lord. You know, maybe as an example, they watch a video about what's going on in the news, gets them all fired up that we're living in the end times, and they come back to the Lord, or they get saved or rededicate their life. And so we have, you know, there's different things that different people need to hear. So I thank God for the ministry that He gave me, and I thank the Lord for everything He's done in me, all the opportunities He gave me. And I know the Lord has, you know, many miles to go, miles and miles to go before I sleep, as I believe Robert Frost said. The Apostle Paul quoted from secular poets himself in the book of Acts when he was at Mars Hill, brothers and sisters. So I thought I would throw that in there. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I got to come back with another video. The Lord was showing me something about the Antichrist, and I need help from Sister Rosemary because she's a savant of my videos, and I made a video about some of this stuff before what the Lord showed me. I'm going to come back with it in another video. God bless you guys. God bless you guys.